This video aims to provide a holistic approach towards explaining Alzheimer's disease. It will explain dementia and Alzheimer's disease, provide details regarding the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's disease, highlight some genetic factors related to the disease, describe symptoms, diagnosis, and treatment options. Dementia is not technically a disease, but more of a way to describe a set of symptoms, like poor memory and difficulty learning new information, which can make it really hard to function independently. Usually, dementia is caused by some sort of damage to the cells in the brain, which can be caused by a variety of diseases. Alzheimer's disease is the most common cause of dementia. Alzheimer's disease is considered to be a neurodegenerative disease, meaning it causes the degeneration or loss of neurons in the brain, particularly in the cortex. This, as you might expect, leads to the symptoms characteristic of dementia. Although the causes of Alzheimer's disease are not completely understood, two major players that are often cited in its progression are plaques and tangles. Let's understand the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's disease. Here, we've got the cell membrane of a neuron in the brain. In the membrane, we have this molecule called amyloid precursor protein, or APP. One end of the protein is inside the cell, and the other end is outside the cell. This protein helps the neuron grow and repair itself after an injury. Since APP is a protein just like other proteins, it gets used up over time and it gets broken down and recycled. Normally, it gets broken down by an enzyme called alpha secretase and gamma secretase. This broken up protein is soluble and everything goes away under normal circumstances. However, if another enzyme, beta secretase, replaces alpha secretase instead, we encounter a problem. Beta secretase breaks down APP from a different location, causing the broken peptide to be a non-soluble molecule. This non-soluble unit of protein forms a molecule called amyloid beta. The chemical composition of amyloid beta causes it to be sticky. Due to this reason, they start to bond together just outside the neurons and form what is called beta amyloid plaques. This plaque can potentially get between the neurons and can interfere with neuron-to-neuron signaling. If the brain cannot signal and relay information, then brain functions like memory and awareness can be seriously impaired. These plaques can also trigger immune response and cause inflammation, which can damage surrounding neurons. A condition called amyloid angiopathy arises when beta amyloid plaques deposit around blood vessels. Amyloid angiopathy weakens the walls of the blood vessels and increases the risk of hemorrhage or rupture and blood loss. Another big part of Alzheimer's disease are tangles. These are found inside the cell. Similar to other cells in the body, neurons are held together by their cytoskeleton, which is partly made up of microtubules. These tract-like structures act like passages for important nutrients and molecules along the length of the cell. A special protein called tau protein makes sure that these passages do not break apart. It is believed that the buildup of beta amyloid plaques outside the neuron initiates pathways inside the neuron that lead to the activation of kinase, an enzyme that transfers phosphate groups to the tau protein. The tau protein then changes its shape, causing it to stop supporting the microtubules and clumps up with other tau proteins and gets tangled. This leads to another characteristic finding of Alzheimer's disease called neurofibrillary tangles. Neurons with tangles and non-functioning microtubules cannot signal as well and sometimes end up undergoing apoptosis, or programmed cell death. As neurons die, visible changes start to take place in the brain. the brain begins to shrink. This is also known as atrophy. The gyri, which are characteristic ridges of the brain, get narrower, and the sulci, which are grooves between the gyri, end up getting wider. The ventricles, which are fluid-filled cavities, also get larger with atrophy. Now that we covered pathophysiology, let's talk about genetics. Why do some people exhibit more symptoms than others? Alzheimer's disease can be split into two groups, sporadic and familial. The term sporadic is used to define the late onset type of Alzheimer's disease, where the exact cause is not very well defined and is probably a combination of genetic and environmental risk factors. In addition, with sporadic Alzheimer's, the risk increases significantly with age. Genes can be thought of as an instruction manual for proteins. There can be many versions of the same gene. These are called alleles. A protein's functionality can be affected by where a specific gene is located within an allele. A gene that has been identified as possibly contributing to an increased risk of Alzheimer's disease is the APOE4 gene. APOE is the name of the protein that the specific gene is coding for, while the E4 is the allele that the gene is located on. This gene codes for the apolipoprotein E, which helps break down the beta amyloid. However, the E4 allele seems to be less effective compared to other alleles, meaning patients are more likely to develop beta amyloid plaques. The term familial Alzheimer's disease is used to describe cases where some dormant gene was inherited that speeds up the progression of the disease. As a result, familial Alzheimer's is referred to as early onset Alzheimer's disease. Mutations in the PSEN1 or PSEN2 genes are linked to early onset Alzheimer's disease. These genes encode for the presylin-1 and presylin-2 protein subunits, which make up the gamma secretase protein. Mutations in these subunits can change the location where gamma secretase breaks the amyloid precursor protein. Producing different lengths of beta amyloid molecules are better at clumping and forming plaques. Symptoms of Alzheimer's disease worsen as plaques and tangles build up and cause damage to the neurons. Symptoms are not detectable during the early stages. As they progress, patients might lose short-term memory, the loss of motor skills and language. Eventually, long-term memory is affected and patients become disoriented and eventually bedridden. Diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease is very tough. The only way to provide evidence that a person has Alzheimer's disease is by performing brain biopsy after autopsy. Currently, there is no cure for Alzheimer's disease. Some medications exist, but they are aimed at slowing down the progression of the disease. Every 4 seconds, someone is diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Being the most common cause of dementia, it affects 40 million people worldwide. Despite of being discovered more than a century ago, it is still not very well understood. Finding a cure is something that eludes researchers till this day.